In order to define Six Sigma, we will have you consider three key questions. First, how hard would it be for you to identify your department's biggest problems? In general, company leaders know where their biggest problems are and can identify them easily. After identifying your top problems, how hard would it be to assign your best people to solve those problems? Your best people are usually the individuals who are keeping the business running on a day-to-day basis and are already dealing with the daily fires associated with your biggest problems. Hence, it is not so uncommon that leaders assign the best and the brightest individuals to their biggest problems within a business. As a result, these people are typically in short supply and, unfortunately, high demand. Finally, how hard would it be to provide your best and brightest people with all the tools, resources, and management support needed to fix your biggest problems? It is common that these people have some tools, resources, and management support available to them, but not enough and not on a consistent basis. The essence of Six Sigma is about identifying our biggest problems, assigning our best people to fix these problems, and providing them with all the tools, resources, and support needed to permanently eliminate these problems. Six Sigma is about doing all of these things, doing them consistently, and doing them well. Before we discuss the Six Sigma methodology, we want to make sure you understand that this methodology forces us to make improvements through data-driven decision-making. Although people frequently believe they are making decisions using data, more often than not, they are just using their intuition. Organizations can take various approaches to how they use data to solve problems. The approach used by a company is related to the level of maturity of its problem-solving methodology. These decision-making levels range from using your intuition and going with a gut feel to qualitative and quantitative brainstorming tools to basic and inferential statistics. The Six Sigma methodology is composed of five phases. These phases are designed to help us observe, collect, and analyze data for the purpose of making decisions. The five phases of Six Sigma are known as DMAIC, which stands for Define, Measure, Analyze, Improve, and Control. The Define phase is where problems and opportunities for improvement are identified. We transform each opportunity identified into a clearly defined Six Sigma project, which means identifying metrics, objectives, and timelines. The Measure and Analyze phases are at the heart of the problem-solving process. These phases focus on determining the relationship between key leverage variables and process outputs. We characterize this relationship by expressing the inputs and outputs of a process with a simple equation, y as a function of x. The improve phase is the time for identifying and implementing solutions to the problems identified in the earlier phases. The control phase is used to establish controls for the proper operation of the process once the project is completed. We also track the results and benefits of the Six Sigma project for a period of 12 months after the improvements have been implemented. The Six Sigma methodology focuses on determining the equation that relates process outputs, called Ys, to process inputs, called Xs. Generically, this equation is referred to as Y as some function of X. We can explore the notion of X's and Y's using numerous analogies. The X's are independent factors, while the Y's are dependent on the X's. The X's can be thought of as inputs to a process, while the Y's are the outputs. The X's can be considered the causes, while the Y's are the effects. The X's are the causes of problems, while the Y's are the symptoms. The X's are what we need to control. The Y's we can only monitor. If we're so good at controlling X's, then why do we constantly focus on inspecting and measuring Y's? If we truly knew the X's that needed to be controlled, we would eliminate our need to constantly inspect and measure Y's. But the reality is that we don't usually know the X's that need to be controlled, and we need the structured problem-solving methodology of Six Sigma to determine what they are. Now let's take a look at the answers you recorded for both exercises. What do these two lists have in common? How close is the owner's list to his customer's list? How in tune is the owner with his customers? If you're like most, as an owner, you ask to see things like ticket sales, concession sales, employee attendance, a listing of which movies are playing, customer complaints, and equipment problems. And as a customer, you probably thought of things like the length of the lines, good-tasting popcorn, clean restrooms, a good quality sound system, availability of parking, and the friendliness of the staff. The difference between these two lists centers on the fact that the customer's needs should drive the items on the owner's list. The owner's list is not information we can directly act on. Instead, it's lacking data that is a consequence of how our customers feel. By the time an item on the owner's list shows a negative trend, something in our customer's needs has been wrong for some time. If we really understand the relationship between X's and Y's, where the X's are the customer's needs and the Y's are the owner's needs, we can directly measure those things that keep us in touch with our customers and act before there's a negative impact on the business. Six Sigma is about improving customer satisfaction. And to do so means understanding what matters to our customers. Once we can link customer satisfaction to internal business processes, we can appropriately drive improvements in our business.